Hello everyone. So after the nice keynote we've heard this morning and this opening ceremony, we are now ready to start with the first scientific session. And this would be the smart therapeutic nanostructures. And it is my pleasure to have here today to introduce to you Maria de la Fuente. She's going to be the chair of this session, and actually she's going to give the first talk. She's currently the head of the Nano-Oncologicals Lab at the Health Research Institute in Santiago de Compostela. And she's going to tell us a little bit about their nanomedicine strategies to improve outcomes of metastatic cancer.
Okay, so thank you very much for your kind introduction. Thank you to the organizers for inviting me to chair this session and also to share this session with all the speakers that will be coming next with very interesting and useful talks. So I'm going to start by introducing what we are actually doing at Santiago de Compostela, trying to use nanomedicine and nanotechnology to find new strategies to battle metastatic cancer. So in Santiago de Compostela, I'm heading the Nano-Oncology Unit, and we are investigating and doing our research work at the hospital. And I believe this is very important because we have the opportunity to discuss every single project that we take over with oncologists, with medical doctors, and with other professionals of the health system that will give us another perspective. Because sometimes we think on the paper or on references that we can really do something, but then we really need to contrast this information with all those professionals that are very close to patients and that can really identify unmet clinical needs. So we work in close collaboration with the medical Translational Medical Oncology Group. And we also use some facilities that are at the hospital, such as the liquid biopsy unit. We also work in close collaboration with the Precision Oncology Rochechus Joint Unit. So this is a really nice environment to try to develop technologies that can really make an impact on the patient's outcomes and to improve the health of oncological patients. What we have all in common in these two groups is that we really want to target metastasis. And this is because metastasis continue to be the main problem to treat cancer. So when we have a primary tumor, treatment is more or less, it can be done. But when the cancer cells spread to a different parts of the body, then we have a systemic disease. Metastatic cancer cells are typically more resistant to treatment. They are more difficult to treat because also because drugs sometimes they don't access well to those cells. And at the end, 90% of metastatic cancer patients eventually die from the disease. Targeting metastasis, apart from that we are speaking about a systemic disease, the problem is that when the cells are in low number, they typically are undetected by common diagnosis methodologies until they start to grow exponentially, and then many times it's too late for a treatment. And on the other side, they are poorly irrigated, so it's really difficult to reach those cells. And thinking about innovative therapeutics that can overcome this drug resistance, many times we speak about biomolecules that also need to enter the cancer cells. So we can really use nanoparticles as carriers for not only for hydrophobic conventional anti-cancer drugs, but also for these biomolecules that can provide different alternatives for treating resistance and metastatic cancer cells. We also need to be aware that now we are in the era of personalized medicine. So we cannot think on treating all cancers the same way. So every patient, every disease condition is different. So we need to make use of all the therapeutic arsenal that is available to find innovative ways of treating metastatic cancer. And we also need to make to be aware that sometimes we need to reach organs that are difficult per se. For example, brain metastasis, overcoming the BBB to reach brain metastasis is still a challenge. Well, this slide here maybe is not necessary, because I guess all of you know that when we speak about nanotechnology, we really are speaking about different options. So we need to select and to decide what we want to use and what we want to do with the technology. So which kind of nanotechnology do we need for a specific application? So we can use different materials, different compositions, architectures, and so on. In our group, we thought that, yes, it's very nice to prepare very complex nanosystems with different polymers that they can react on the environment. So this is really good and really challenging and very motivating for us as nanotechnologists. But we think that if we want to improve the translational potential, we need to keep it simple. So we decided to work on this way. So trying to develop nanosystems that are very simple in composition, very easy to prepare, and that have more chances of translation. In the last years, we started to work on this way, and eventually we were able to develop a type of nanocarrier that is composed only by two components for starters, and we can increase the complexity if we want. Can be prepared in a very simple way in seconds. We already performed some biocompatibility studies. We know that they are biodegradable, stable over time, up to a year at 4 degrees. So we think that we are quite happy with this technology. We go down and really decide to work as simple as possible. This is the way as we prepare the nanoparticles. Of course, we need to scale up because this is 1 milliliter, and but we already reach higher volumes, but we still need to continue scaling up. But this is very simple. We don't use organic solvents other than ethanol, and we get a very homogeneous distribution. The components are sphingomyelin, the main component, which is a lipid that we can find in cell membranes and is assimilable by the body, and an oil normally we like vitamin E, which is a very well-known excipient. So it's a fast methodology of production, simple and highly reproducible. After having this, we started to test what we can really do with these nanoparticles. So we want to explore if they could be used for in vivo imaging for diagnosis purposes, if they can be used for therapy, and how many different types of therapeutics we can encapsulate or associate, thinking on the concept of personalized medicine and precision oncology. And we also wanted to explore different targeting approaches, because we need to bear in mind that we need to improve the access of the nanoparticles to metastatic cancer cells. Within the first, for diagnosis purposes, we work mainly with radio labeling, because it's the most common diagnosis way for cancer, which is applied in clinics. So we optimize the process, and we use for starters gallium, either 68 or 67. So the same way of labeling can be used for either PET or SPECT, for two different modalities of imaging. We had a good efficiency of radio labeling and stable in serum. And of course, these experiments we did in collaboration with people from the Medicine Nuclear Service of Santiago and also from the CENIC. So first images show that indeed we can track and follow the nanoparticles in the body. And now we need to still work on, first of all, we would like to change the radio label, because gallium has a very short half-life, so we want to replace it by zirconium. And we also want to improve the stealth properties to be able to target the metastatic cancer cells. But at least we know that we can be efficient in the radio labeling process and have a product, a nanoparticle, that can be followed after in vivo administration. We also try to label with iron nanoparticles for MRI, and we can also detect the nanoparticles in vivo. So coming back to therapy, as I mentioned before, we are really interested on the personalized medicine concept. So we evaluate the potential of our nanoparticles to encapsulate different types of anti-cancer drugs. So we encapsulated hydrophobic drugs, peptides, nucleic acids, and proteins. But what I want to show here is that we have a collaboration with a research group from the CICUS, with Rebecca Fandiño, because they do molecular dynamics. They were able to simulate our nanoparticles, and we find out first that the materials are disposing as we believe. So we follow this in vitro in silico approach. And then they were also modulating the different drugs, and we could actually verify that the molecular dynamics results correlate very well with our experimental results. So we think that now we have a tool to predict which type of drugs we can actually encapsulate or associate to our nanoparticles without being doing a lot of experiments to find out. We also work in gene therapy because, as I mentioned before, metastatic cancer cells are resistant to therapeutics, and we need to explore different types of therapeutics. We are particularly interested in microRNAs mimics because also we can use the different combinations of microRNAs mimics, oncosuppressor microRNAs, and these experiments are part of the PhD of the thesis of Abby. So we found out that our nanoparticles encapsulate well the RNA, and we can deliver to cells, but also when we inject it in vivo in animal models, so they accumulate in the lung where the tumoral cells were. And we find out by immunofluorescence that this was like this, in this way. We also use a new model that is the zebrafish embryos in collaboration with Roberto Piñeiro and with Professor Laura Sanchez from Santiago, because we want to have an intermediate model that allow us to screen the different therapeutic alternatives for metastatic cancer without waiting for mice models that are really expensive, tedious, and when they are close to a biological situation, they are really, really expensive. So this model can be an intermediate model, because if you inject cells around here, if they metastasize, they accumulate here. So we can see if our treatments can stop cells from migration, from going to these distal sites. There are also models with green macrophages that allow to determine if particles are taken up by macrophages. There are also some other zebrafish embryos models that have like the blood vessels staining green. So there are a lot of different possibilities. We also want to explore a different kind of biomolecules, such as antitumoral peptides. And in this case, we select a peptide that is interacting with this guanidyl cyclase C receptor, because this is a receptor that is expressed in the intestinal tissue, but is not expressed in extra-intestinal tissue. So it is quite interesting, too, for metastatic colorectal cancer cells. For example, in the liver, this receptor is not expressed at all, but metastatic colorectal cancer cells go to the liver. So this is a peptide, and to be able to encapsulate it or to associate to our nanoparticles, we did a chemical modification first with a hydrophobic change so that the peptide could be exposed onto the surface and inserted into our nanocarriers. After checking that by different methodologies like MALDI-TOF, NMR, and so on, we encapsulated to the nanoparticles, we characterized them, and then we did some activity assays because the peptide also has a therapeutic effect. So it is already described. So it can be used for targeting and also for therapy. So we found out that if we increase the dose, actually it interferes with the forming of colonies. This is a colony formation assay. So at higher doses, there are no colonies seen. But importantly, we can develop combinatory therapies. If we encapsulate etoposide up to a concentration of 500 nanomolar, this is subtherapeutic. So they are doing nothing to the cells, to cancer cells. But if we combine with this peptide, we got an effect. And this is important because it will allow us not only to target the nanoparticles to the metastatic cancer cells, but also work at subtherapeutic doses of hydrophobic anti-cancer drugs. This is an in vivo experiment, and we can see that the combination of both drugs actually decreased the tumor growth. With respect to the targeting, we would like to also explore how many things we can do with this technology. So we had some data, and we can decorate the nanoparticles with small molecules that are modified with a hydrophobic change. We can also use peptides, as I have just shown with this guanidyl cyclase C receptor. We can also add antibodies on the surface, and we are now starting to explore if we can also use aptamers for decorating, surface decorating our nanoparticles. But what is important, and because we are working in a hospital and we have access to other resources, we thought that, yeah, of course, it is very difficult to understand how metastatic cancer cells are, what they have different from cells in the primary tumor, because it's complicated to get samples, metastases are normally not, biopsies are not typically taken. If they are taken, they are for molecular pathology, so it's very difficult to understand. But at the hospital, and in the Oncomet group, we have the liquid biopsy unit, and they are really specialists in analyzing tumoral material that are present in the blood. So they analyze circulating tumor cells and other material such as tumoral DNA. And liquid biopsy is used for monitoring therapies, for as a predictive, for finding predictive biomarkers to determine progression, but also to see how the, because tumors are dynamic, how the tumor are changing. Using liquid biopsy, we isolated cancer, circulating tumor cells from patients with metastatic lung cancer, and after doing a molecular study, we could identify a protein, a receptor, that is present in these circulating tumor cells. This all in collaboration with the liquid biopsy unit. And we found out, we had to filter, because for targeting, we really want that the protein or the receptor is expressed at the cell membrane. So we, of all the genes that were differentially expressed, we filter and we study, determine the different pathways, function, but mainly the location. So it has to be at the plasma membrane. And we find out this receptor that is a taste receptor and normally is present in the tongue. So what is doing in tumoral cells, we still don't know. We are now also investigating why a receptor that is in the tongue is also present in circulating tumor cells. Probably it has to do some good metabolism. So this is, we analyze more patients, more samples to validate the results, and we also study some tumor samples from primary tumors, and we found out that a pathologist says that they are, the protein is mainly in those cells that have a morphology that is close to an stem-like morphology. So we injected, we also selected in vitro different cells with different expression levels. So high levels of TAS1R3 receptor, low levels, we injected in nude mice in the flank and followed the tumor growth, study if there were circulating tumor cells in there, and also disseminated tumor cells that went from the flank to the lungs, to the metastatic site. First of all, when the cells had low levels of this receptor, we couldn't find any circulating tumor cells. But with high levels of expression of this sweet taste receptor, we could find circulating tumor cells in the blood of the mice. So the receptor has to do with tumoral dissemination and formation of metastasis. Then, when the mice were sacrificed after 47 days, we studied the lungs and find out that when the cells had higher levels of receptor, there were much more cells in the lungs, so much more cells disseminated and went from the flank to the lungs. And also, after studying the expression of different markers, we found out that, of course, our receptor was high, expressed, but also other receptors that are related with a stem-like phenotype. This makes sense because circulating tumor cells are related also with a stem-like phenotype, so it makes a lot of sense. This is a study where we, if you culture the cells, lung cells, cancer cells in 3D, they have a stem-like phenotype. So we culture different in collaboration with people from the, with researchers from the university and the Hospital of Valencia. So they have a lot of different kinds of cancer cells, and also cancer cells derived from patients, from primary cultures. So they culture it in them in 2D and also in 3D with a stem-like phenotype. And when they are culturing in 3D, there is an increase in the levels of the expression of this receptor that was also verified by immunofluorescence. And this is a second mouse model that we also use to double check that indeed the receptor has something to do with cell dissemination and formation of metastasis. So in a CDX, CDX is when you prepare a tumor from circulating tumor cells. It grows much more when the cells were positive for this receptor, and also 72% of the cells that express the receptor have an stem-like phenotype. So, coming back to nanotechnology, which is the main issue, no? Because we explore this biomarker to target nanomedicines to metastatic cancer cells. So, this was the main purpose. So, there are some ligands that are described for these receptors, such as lactisol and brassein, that is a protein. Lactisol is an edulcorant, so we decided to start with lactisol because it's cheap, it's more easy to get. So, we decorated our nanoparticles with this small molecule. We modify the molecule with a C18 change to be able to insert it on the nanoparticle structure, which characterize the nanoparticles, and we performed some in vitro experiments to confirm that when the particles were decorated, they were more internalized in those cells that were positive for the receptor. We performed some in vitro cytotoxy assays, and we confirmed that the particles that were decorated had a bigger capacity to deliver the drugs intracellularly. But we are also exploring other options. One of the problems that we have to target this receptor is that we don't have tools. So we don't have molecular monoclonal antibodies available. We don't have other types of ligands because they are not described yet. But we are collaborating with a company and with a research group that are experts in aptamer technology. So they were selecting some aptamers that are able to interact strongly and very specific for this receptor. And having now these aptamers, we are working on surface decorating our nanoparticles with this. So this is a talk. I just wanted to give you an overview of what we are doing and why I think it's very important to be open and to take a look around and try to use the resources that we have. For example, working in a clinical environment, collaborating not only with the medical doctors, but also with other units that are experts in analyzing the tumors and understanding which is the molecular biology. So we can use all this knowledge to try to build a product that can eventually have an impact on the well-being of oncological patients with metastatic cancer. So all this information we now pack it and decided to identify an unmet clinical need and ask for funding to continue our research. And this project I will be presenting tomorrow in the session of the European projects, but it's a Metastark. There is also a partner of the project seated here, Esperanta. We are a group of persons from different parts of Europe, and the purpose is targeting micrometastases when they are very small. For this, we will use all the knowledge that we have been generating during the last years. So we will be radiolabeling the particles. We will be using surface decorated nanoparticles towards this receptor that we have identified. We have people involved with models that are very close to a real situation. We also have a company, people with expertise in physicochemical study of interactions of the particles with plasmatic proteins. So we think we have a good consortium. So now we are trying to resolve this unmet clinical need. And well, thank you very much for your attention. And I'm open to questions, comments here or after in the coffee break. Thank you.
Thank you, Maria, for this interesting talk. We have time for a couple of quick questions.
Hello, very nice talk.
Thank you
very much. So you You talk a lot about the met clinical needs, which I think it's the mm-hmm. right approach, where we've done a lot of studies where we have really reached a very level of maturity for the nanotechnologies. At the same time, I thought I would like to know what's going to be your angle just to face the current difficulties and the limits of the techniques that we do. For example, we know the nanoparticles, biological fluid, they form the corona, then the binding site of the receptor is gone, the circulation in the bloodstream is not long enough because the particles are trapped in the liver or they are secreted, or the nanoparticles might just not survive long. So just was wondering if you, obviously your data are amazing, but I just would like to know how you're going to address each of these challenges.
Yeah, I mean, I agree that we still need to take into consideration all the technology development aspects that are fundamental and crucial. So we have an application on mind, but we are really aware that what we need to do. So for overcoming these barriers that you are mentioning, we have bring to the consortium research groups with expertise in understanding how our nanoparticles are going to interact with plasmatic proteins so we can optimize the surface property. For us, it's easy to change the surface properties because we can insert different pegs in a very easy way. So we already have some knowledge that will help us to optimize quite fast. I mean, we have already knowledge on that. But we also have some persons, some researchers, which are experts in microfluidics. So we are going to simulate also the blood vessels, see if the particles can extravasate or not. We are also going to use the zebrafish with the vessels stained in green to understand a bit how this works and how can we improve the circulation times. There are also a group that have biomimetics and biological models in 3D that will also help us to understand. Of course, we need to keep in mind the unmet clinical needs, but also be aware that we really need to work on the technology. So I fully agree with you. We have to go through all these aspects to improve and to reach the aim. But the aim has to be very clear because it's not the same to optimize for this application and for other different applications. It's not the same targeting the lungs that targeting the pancreas. So the unmet clinical needs had to be there, and then we need to work towards that.
Any other question? If not, let's thank the speaker again.
Okay, thank you.